In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophesying. Prove all things, hold fast that which is good. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman who needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Welcome to the Three Angels Herald Prophecy Seminar. We invite you to take your Bible, pen and paper as we study the Word of God. Our speaker for today is Jimmy Kakuri.
Welcome once again, my beloved brethren, in the precious and worthy name of Jesus. I want to thank you so much once again for taking the time to join me as we search and dig deep into the mind of God's truth. As usual, God has a blessed message for us in store today. And the study today will be taken from the second chapter of Daniel, the great image of Daniel chapter 2. And as I said, I know that God has a blessing in store for us today. However, before we go into our presentation for today, I just want to take this brief moment to read a thought from the pen of inspiration. Now, the thought is coming from the book Counsels to Writers and Editors, and I'm going to be reading a few paragraphs beginning from page 35 and then page 37. It's under the title Attitude to New Light. Inspiration says, there is no excuse for anyone in taking the position that there is no more truth to be revealed and that all our expositions of Scripture are without an error. The fact that certain doctrines have been held as truth for many years by our people is not a proof that our ideas are infallible. Age will not make error into truth, and truth can afford to be fair. No true doctrine will lose anything by close investigation. Now on page 37, inspiration says, we have many lessons to learn and many to unlearn. God and heaven alone are infallible. Those who think that they will never have to give up a cherished view, never have occasion to change an opinion, will be disappointed. As long as we hold to our own ideas and opinions with determined persistency, we cannot have the unity for which Christ prayed. Very solemn and profound words indeed. Inspiration first of all says on page 35, the fact that certain doctrines have been held as truth by our people for many years is no evidence that all our expositions of Scripture are without an error. Age will not make error into truth, and truth can afford to be fair. And no true doctrine, inspiration says, will lose anything by close investigation. Now on page 37, inspiration says, we have many lessons to learn and many to unlearn. God and heaven alone are infallible. And those who think that they will never have to give up a cherished view, never have occasion to change an opinion, they will be disappointed. And as long as we hold on to these views, we can never have the unity for which Christ prayed for. Now on page 44 of the same book, inspiration says, the last paragraph on page 44, inspiration says, if the pillars of our faith will not stand the test of investigation, it is time that we knew it. There must be no spirit of Phariseeism cherished among us. When Christ came to his own, his own received him not. And it is a matter of solemn interest to us that we should not pursue a similar course in refusing light from heaven. Very solemn statement indeed, brethren. If the pillars of our faith will not stand the test of investigation, then it is time that we knew it. And I pray, my beloved brothers and sisters, as we go into this precious message for today, that these thoughts may be kept vividly in our minds. At this time, I'll invite you to pray with me as we beseech the throne of grace. Our loving Father in heaven, Lord, we want to thank you so much for all your love, your kindness, your mercies. I pray that your blood will cover us and sanctify us, and that your precious Holy Spirit will guide us into all truth. Speak to us now, for your people wait to hear your voice. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Once again, my brothers and sisters, I want to thank you so much for joining me as we dig deep into the mind of God's precious truth. Now, if you will turn with me to the book of Daniel chapter 2, and we're going to be reading various different verses to begin with in relation to the dream that King Nebuchadnezzar had. Now, we're going to be reading the first 6 verses to begin with. And in Daniel chapter 2 and verse 1, the Bible says, "And in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar dreamed dreams wherewith his spirit was troubled, and his sleep brake from him. Then the king commanded to call the magicians and the astrologers and the sorcerers and the Chaldeans for to show the king his dream. So they came and stood before the king. And the king said unto them, I have dreamed a dream, and my spirit was troubled to know the dream. Then spake the Chaldeans to the king in Syriac, O king, live forever. Tell thy servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation. The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, the thing is gone from me. If ye will not make known unto me the dream with the interpretation thereof, ye shall be cut in pieces, and your houses shall be made a dunghill. But if you will show the dream and the interpretation thereof, ye shall receive of me gifts and rewards and great honor. Therefore show me the dream and the interpretation thereof." Verse 10, "The Chaldeans answered before the king and said, there is not a man upon the earth that can show the king's matter. Therefore there is no king, lord, nor ruler that ask of such things at any magicians or astrologers or Chaldean. And it is a rare thing that the king requireth. And there is none other that can show it before the king except the gods whose dwelling is not with flesh. For this cause the king was angry and very furious, and commanded to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. And the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain, and they sought Daniel and his fellows to be slain. Then Daniel answered with counsel and wisdom to Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, which was gone forth to slay the wise men of Babylon. He answered and said to Arioch, the king's captain, why is the decree so hasty from the king? Then Arioch made the thing known to Daniel. Verse 16, "Then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time, and that he would show the king the interpretation." Now in verse 19, the Bible says, "Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven." Now if we go to verse 24, the Bible says, "Therefore Daniel went in unto Arioch, whom the king had ordained to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and said thus unto him, destroy not the wise men of Babylon. Bring me in before the king, and I will show unto the king the interpretation. Then Arioch brought in Daniel before the king in haste, and said thus unto him, I have found a man of the captives of Judah that will make known unto the king the interpretation. The king answered and said unto Daniel, whose name was Belshazzar, art thou able to make known unto me the dream which I have dreamed or seen, and the interpretation thereof? Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, the secret which the king has demanded, cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers show unto the king. But there is a God in heaven that revealeth secrets and maketh known unto the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. Thy dream and the visions of thy head upon thy bed are these. That is beautiful indeed, my beloved brothers and sisters. Now in verse 27, when Daniel was brought in before the king, Daniel answered and said, the secret which the king requires, cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, or the Chaldeans show unto the king? But there is a God in heaven that revealeth secrets and maketh known unto the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. So very clearly we see, my beloved brethren, that this chapter, the second chapter of Daniel, is to me its complete fulfillment in the latter days. Now we know furthermore that according to Daniel chapter 12 and verse 4, the book of Daniel was to be a sealed book. Daniel was told to close the book and to seal it even until the time of the end. And the very fact that these prophecies are being revealed to us in a remarkable way is evidence in itself that we are living in the time of the end. Now let's go on to verse 31. In Daniel chapter 2, verses 31 to 35, Daniel then begins to explain to the king what he had dreamt. Let's go to verse 31. The Bible says, thou, O king, sawest and behold a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. This image's head was of gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. Thou sawest to that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon its feet, that were iron and clay, and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken in pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image, verse 35, became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. So in verse 31, my beloved brethren, the Bible says, as Daniel began to explain to the king what he had dreamt, he says, thou sawest and beheldest a great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee. And then Daniel began to explain to the king that the head of this great image was of gold. The silver breast and arms was of silver. His thighs of brass and his legs were iron, referring to the four ancient kingdoms. The four ancient kingdoms. But if we take our Bibles one more time and we go to verse 41 and we're going to be reading right through to verse 43, we're going to see that Daniel begins to explain to the king something about the 10 toes. Let's go to verse 41. In verse 41, the Bible says, and whereas thou sawest the feet and the toes, part of potter's clay and part of iron, the kingdom shall be divided, but there shall be in it of the strength of the iron. For as much as thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay, and as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken. And whereas thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with miry clay. So Daniel, after explaining the four ancient kingdoms, Daniel went on to explain something of the 10 toes. And he begins by saying that these 10 toes were made and mixed with miry clay and iron. Now we know that clay and iron does not mix. Now, the 10 toes do actually represent our present world. In other words, the fifth period, if you will. The world succeeding the fall of Rome. Now, in Volume 1, Testaments to the Church, page 361, Inspiration says, We need not and cannot expect union amongst the nations of the earth. Our position in the image of Nebuchadnezzar is represented by the tolls in a divided state and of a crumbling material that will not hold together. Prophecy shows us that the great day of God is right upon us. It hasteneth greatly. Very clear, my brothers and sisters, the Bible inspiration says that our position in the image of King Nebuchadnezzar is found in the tolls of a crumbling material that will not hold together. And the prophecy shows us that the great day of God is right upon us. It hasteneth greatly. But very clear it is that our position in the image of King Nebuchadnezzar is represented by the tolls. In other words, the tolls symbolizes our present world. And being 10, the number 10 symbolizes universality. Universality. And we can see this from various different ways in the Bible. In the parable of the 10 virgins in Matthew 25, Christ referred to the parable of the 10 virgins. Now, the parable of the 10 virgins symbolizes the Seventh-day Adventist church universally on this earth right now. We can also see that from the book of Revelation chapter 13 and verse 1, where John refers to a leopard-like beast having 10 horns, and also the 10 horns on the scarlet-colored beast. These beasts are universal. Thus we see that the number 10 symbolizes universality. Now, the 10 tolls, again, symbolizes our present world. In other words, they symbolize a multiplicity of kings. They do not just symbolize 10 nations. They symbolize a multiplicity of kings. In other words, both leftists and rightists. So the 10 tolls symbolize our present world. And it's very important to understand that, brethren, because as we go on to find out, the Bible says that the stone that was cut out without hands, it smote the image upon the feet that were partly iron and partly clay, and then broke the whole image to pieces. The stone did not smite the head or the legs that were of iron, but it smote the toes right down in our present world. So let's go on now, brethren. As I said before, in verse 34, the Bible says in Daniel chapter 2 and verse 34, Daniel explained to the king, he says, "Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, and that it smote the image upon the feet that were partly iron and partly clay. And then it broke the whole image to pieces. And after the stone that was cut out without hands smote the image," according to verse 35, notice what happens to the stone. The Bible says the stone then grows and becomes a great mountain again and fills the whole earth. The stone then grows and becomes a great mountain and fills the whole earth. Now, as we've seen, brothers and sisters, this whole prophecy in Daniel chapter 2 is to meet its complete fulfillment in the last days. And that's very important to keep in mind. Now, we need to understand now, since the Bible says the stone was cut out, that goes to show that it came from somewhere. It came from someplace. Now, we need to understand now, brothers and sisters, and we need to see from the Bible, from where was the stone cut out from? Let's go to Daniel chapter 2, and let's have a look at verse 45. In verse 45, the Bible says, "For as much as thou sawest that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it brake in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, and the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what shall come to pass hereafter, and the dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof sure." Wow. So very clearly we see from the Bible that the stone was cut out of the mountain. It was cut out from the mountain without hands. Now verse 34 of Daniel chapter 2 It doesn't really tell us in verse 34 from where the stone actually was cut out from. It just says, thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands. But verse 45 tells us that the stone was cut out from the mountain without hands. And after the stone smote the image upon its feet, that were partly iron and partly clay, then the stone then grows again and becomes a great mountain, according to verse 35. Now, my beloved brothers and sisters, we need to understand that this whole prophecy and vision is a symbolic vision. The head of gold was symbolic of the kingdom of Babylon. The silver breast and arm, symbolic of the kingdom of Medo-Persia. The brass was symbolic of the third kingdom, the kingdom of Grecia. The iron legs was symbolic of the kingdom of Rome. Now, the ten toes was symbolic of our present world. Therefore, the mountain must be symbolic of something, and also the stone that was cut out from the mountain. Also, the phrase cut out without hands, what does that really mean? And the actual smiting or breaking of the feet by the stone. We're going to see that this is all symbolic, my beloved brothers and sisters. And also the stone growing once again and becoming a great mountain and filling the whole earth. But first of all, let's go to the Bible and find out, because it's very important to find this out. Since the stone came from the mountain, we need to understand, what does the mountain symbolize? Since we are in the book of Daniel, let's go to Daniel chapter 9. In Daniel chapter 9 and verse 20, the Bible says in verse 20, and whilst I was speaking and praying and confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God for the holy mountain of my God. Now here in Daniel chapter 9 and verse 20, the very famous prayer of Daniel. Daniel says, while I was speaking and praying and confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God for the holy mountain of my God. Very clear it is, brethren, that here Daniel was praying for Israel, the church, and he likens Israel unto a holy mountain. So here we see from Daniel chapter 9 and verse 20 that God's word likens the church, Israel, unto a holy mountain. Let's go to two more verses. In Isaiah chapter 2 and verse 2, the Bible says, and it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations will flow into it. Again, this prophecy is to meet its fulfillment in the last days, but the point is, Isaiah says, and it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house, the mountain of the Lord's church, shall be established in the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills. And then it says, all nations will flow into God's house, God's church. Very clearly again we see, brethren, that the mountain symbolizes God's church. Let's just go to one more text. In Isaiah 56 and verse 7, Isaiah chapter 56 and verse 7, the Bible says, even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Now, when you read in the context of Isaiah 56, for example, if you read verse 6, God's word is referring to the strangers, the Gentiles, who will embrace the Sabbath truth in the last days. So in verse 7, when the Bible says even them, it's referring to the Gentiles. But the point is, verse 7 says, even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Very clearly again we see that the mountain symbolizes God's house, God's church. Now we have seen, brethren, from the weight of evidence that a mountain symbolizes God's church. And since this prophecy, according to Daniel chapter 2 and verse 28, was to meet its fulfillment in the last days, then it's so clear that the mountain referred to in Daniel chapter 2 refers to the church of Christ in the last days. Now, which church is Christ using? Which church is God using in these last days? Which movement did he raise up in 1844? That's right, brethren. This blessed movement, the Seventh-day Adventist Church. In other words, the mountain from where the stone was cut out from symbolizes the Seventh-day Adventist Church. The movement and the church that God raised up in 1844 and to whom God gave the three angels' messages of Revelation chapter 14, verses 6 through to 12. Now, this mountain could not symbolize the nominal churches of Christendom, because according to Revelation chapter 14 and verse 8, since 1844, they have been in a fallen condition. So clear it is, brethren, that this mountain symbolizes the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now, we're coming to a very crucial point in our study, brethren. Now, remember the prayer thought in Counsels to Writers and Editors, page 35, inspiration says, "The fact that certain doctrines have been held as truth by our people for many years is no evidence that all our expositions of Scripture are without an error. Age will not make error into truth, and truth can afford to be fair. And no true doctrine will lose anything by close investigation. No true doctrine will lose anything by close investigation." Now, since the mountain symbolizes the church of God in the last days, then it is evident, brethren, that the fact that the stone came from the mountain, the church, and the stone only being a smaller portion of what the mountain is, then that's evidence in itself that the stone can only symbolize a portion, a smaller portion, of what the mountain really symbolizes. And we've seen that the mountain symbolizes the church of Christ in the last days. So the stone can only symbolize a smaller portion of what the mountain is. Now, we're going to see, brethren, that the stone does indeed symbolize a remnant from the Seventh-day Adventist Church, cut out by a supernatural power. The phrase "without hands" goes to show that the stone was cut out by God's almighty hand. Naturally, human beings make things and do things with their hands, but it's without hands, showing that it's without human help. We're going to go on to explain something more about what this really means, brethren, because what it's really showing us is that God is to separate a people from the Seventh-day Adventist Church, a remnant from the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And then when God separates them, he will then send them to the nations, symbolized by the 10 toes. And we're also going to see what is symbolized by the actual breaking of the toes by the stone and the actual growing of the stone and becoming a great mountain. Now, we need to understand, my beloved brothers and sisters, whom and what does this stone symbolize? Who does the stone symbolize? Let's just go to Jeremiah chapter 51, just for a moment. In Jeremiah chapter 51, verses 19 and 20, Jeremiah 51, verses 19 and 20, the Bible says, "The portion of Jacob is not like them, for he is the former of all things, and Israel is the rod of his inheritance. The Lord of hosts is his name." Verse 20 says, "Thou art my battle axe and weapons of war. For with thee will I break in pieces the nations, and with thee will I destroy kingdoms." Now, verse 19 very clearly says, the portion of Jacob, not all of Jacob, but the portion of Jacob is not like them. For he is the form of all things, and Israel is the rod of his inheritance. Now, in verse 20, the Bible says, referring to the portion of Jacob, God says, "Thou art my battle axe and weapons of war, and with thee will I break in pieces the nations." Now, don't miss the thought, because the same work is foretold in Daniel chapter 2. The stone breaks in pieces the nations. And God likens the portion of Jacob here, the church, unto a battle axe. And with this battle axe, he will break in pieces the nations. Now, in volume 1, Testimonies to the Church, page 608, inspiration says, In concluding this narrative, I would say that we are living in a most solemn time. In the last vision given me, I was shown the startling fact that but a small portion of those who now profess the truth will be sanctified by it and be saved. Many will get above the simplicity of the work. They will conform to the world, cherish idols, and become spiritually dead. The humble self-sacrificing followers of Jesus will pass on to perfection, leaving behind the indifferent and lovers of the world. Again, brethren, inspiration says, in concluding this narrative, I saw the startling fact that but a small portion of those who now profess the truth will be finally sanctified by it and be saved. That's exactly what we saw in Jeremiah chapter 51, verses 19 and 20, the portion of Jacob. And God likens his people unto a battle axe that will break in pieces the nations. And we're going to see, brethren, that this breaking in pieces is not a literal thing, that God's people are going to literally go through with a battle axe. No, we're going to see that this breaking in pieces will actually be done through the everlasting gospel, through the final proclamation of the everlasting gospel. God's people in these last days, symbolized by this stone, the remnant, through the proclamation of the everlasting gospel, will break in pieces the kingdoms of this world. During that time, when the mark of the beast system, when the image of the beast system would have been enforced during that time. And we're going to see that, my beloved brothers and sisters. Now let's have a look now. Let's go to the Bible and really see, since this stone is a remnant, it can only be, because the mountain symbolizes the church and the stone is just a smaller portion of people, the remnant cut out from the mountain. Who are these people? Who are these people? Let's go to Zechariah chapter 12 and verse 3. In Zechariah chapter 12 and verse 3. Zechariah is just before Malachi. Zechariah chapter 12 and verse 3. The Bible says in verse 3, and in that day will I make Jerusalem, which is a symbol of the church, a burdensome stone for all people. All that burden themselves with it shall be cut in pieces, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it. Did you get the point, brethren? Here we see God says, and in that day will I make Jerusalem, the church, a burdensome stone. So very clearly God likens the church unto a burdensome stone for all people. And then God says, all that burden themselves with it, the stone, shall be what? Cut in pieces, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it. Very clearly we see, brethren, that this stone in Zechariah 12 and verse 3 does the same work as the stone of Daniel chapter 2. It breaks in pieces. And here we see that this stone, God is symbolizing this stone by the church, Jerusalem. Let's go to Zechariah chapter 3, brethren. In Zechariah chapter 3, in Zechariah chapter 3, and verse 8 and 9, follow very carefully. The Bible says, hear now, O Joshua the high priest, thou and thy fellows, who are these people that sit before thee? For they are men wondered at. For behold, I will bring forth my servant the branch, who is Christ. Verse 9 says, for behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua, upon one stone shall be seven eyes. Behold, I will engraven the graven thereof, saith the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day. Now, brethren, we need to dig deep into these scriptures to really understand their true meaning. Verse 8, Zechariah in vision, he says, hear now, O Joshua the high priest, thou and thy fellows that sit before thee, for they are men wondered at. So verse 8, Zechariah saw these fellows that were sitting before Joshua the high priest, and they were referred to as being men wondered at. Who are these men wondered at that were sitting before Joshua? Don't miss the point. They were sitting before Joshua. Look up verse 9. Bible says, "For behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua." Well, who was sitting before Joshua? Who were laid before Joshua? The men wondered at, the fellows. So here we see that in verse 9, the Bible is actually referring to the men wondered at as being the stone with seven eyes. Now, the men wondered at, brothers and sisters, having seven eyes, complete spiritual vision, is showing us that these people, the men wondered at, symbolized by the stone, will have that keen spiritual perception to detect sin under any guise. They will have the eye solve. They will be able to detect sin under any guise. So let's go into the more sure word of prophecy now to actually reinforce that these men wondered at, whom the Bible is referring to as being the stone, are indeed men wondered at. Who are they? Let's go to Prophets and Kings. In the book Prophets and Kings, page 591. Prophets and Kings, page 591. The last paragraph, the bottom of the paragraph, page 591, inspiration says, "These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God." Revelation 14, verses 4 and 5. The 144,000. Now don't miss the point. The next paragraph, inspiration says, after referring to the 144,000, inspiration says in the very next paragraph, "Now is reached the complete fulfillment of the words of the angel. Hear now, O Joshua the high priest, thou and thy fellows that sit before thee, for they are men wondered at." Oh, my beloved brethren, inspiration very clearly tells us that the 144,000 of Revelation 14, 4 and 5 represent the men wondered at. She says, "Now is reached the complete fulfillment of the words of the angel. Hear now, O Joshua the high priest, thou and thy fellows that sit before thee, for they are men wondered at." It is indeed the 144,000 who are indeed the men wondered at of Zechariah 3 and verse 8. And since that is the case, then verse 9, the stone having seven eyes, is synonymous with the men wondered at. Because in verse 9, the Bible says, "Behold, for behold the stone that I have laid before Joshua." Who were before Joshua? The men wondered at, the fellows. So very clearly we see from the Bible and the spirit of prophecy, brethren, that the 144,000 are indeed this stone, the remnant cut out from the mountain, that great people and a strong, that have never been or ever shall be, even to the years of many generations. Joel chapter 2 and verse 2. In Obadiah 1 verse 21, the Bible says, "And saviors," plural, "shall come up on Mount Zion to judge the Mount of Esau." Who was standing on Mount Zion in Revelation 14 and verse 1? The 144,000. They're called saviors, brethren, in Obadiah 1 21, because the 144,000, after they escape the purification of the church, of which we're going to look into in just a moment, after they're cut out, separated, when they escape the purification of the church, these purified ones will be sent as missionaries to the nations afar off who have not heard God's fame, neither have seen his glory, and they will declare the third angel's message as it swells into a loud cry. And as a result of that, the second fruits will come out from Babylon's domain. And that's what actually causes the stone to grow from its first fruit phase. Because the 144,000 are only the first fruits. Revelation 14 and verse 4. They are the first fruits of the great harvest field. And this stone symbolizes the first fruits of God's kingdom church. And when the 144,000 go to all the nations, no wonder inspiration says, brethren, in 7 Bible Commentary, page 971, let us strive with all the power that God has given us to be among the 144,000, because these great people will be the ones that escape and that will be sent as missionaries, as we're going to see, according to Isaiah 66 and verse 19, to proclaim the last message of warning to a dying and perishing world. And the fact that the stone then grows after it smites the image, and the actual smiting symbolizes that through the everlasting gospel, the image of the beast system during that time will be broken, and as a result, Revelation 18 and verse 4 will be fulfilled. When John says, and I heard another voice saying, come out of her, my people. The majority of God's children now, brethren, are still to be found in the other nominal churches of Christendom. And according to John chapter 10 and verse 16, Jesus says, other sheep have I, which are not of this fold, them too must I bring. When will he bring them? After he cuts out the stone, after God pours out the Holy Spirit upon the 144,000, then the 144,000 will then go to the nations and proclaim the loud cry message of Revelation 18 and verse 1. And then again, the fact that the stone grows, it shows without a shadow of a doubt that this can only happen during probationary time. God's church cannot grow after Jesus comes, or when he comes in the clouds of heaven. Because when Jesus comes in the clouds of heaven, by that time he would have already thrown down the censer, according to Revelation 22 and verse 11, and pronounced those words, let him who is filthy, let him be filthy still, and so forth. No more atoning blood can atone for any sinners. So again, this is showing us that this growth can only take place before Jesus comes, which shows us again, brethren, that this stone cannot symbolize Jesus at his second coming. That's one reason. Furthermore, this stone grows and becomes a great mountain. Does Jesus personally grow and become a great mountain, a great church? Certainly not, brethren. Furthermore, who is greater than Jesus to cut him out from the mountain? Christ is Almighty God. So we've seen very clearly, brethren, and that's why inspiration says, the fact that certain doctrines have been held as truth by our people for many years is no proof that all our expositions of Scripture are without an error. Age will not make error into truth, and truth can afford to be fair. And that's why inspiration says, if the pillars of our faith cannot withstand the investigation, then it's time that we knew it, brethren. It's time that we knew it. Because when the storm comes, if our feet are not planted upon the eternal rock of God's everlasting truth, the rock Christ Jesus, the rock of truth, we will not be able to stand, brethren. But we've seen very clearly that the Bible refers to the church, the purified church, the 144,000, as being this stone of Daniel chapter 2, brethren. Let's go to Isaiah 66. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 66, we're going to see everything that we have been talking about, brethren, in Isaiah chapter 66. Let's go there. In Isaiah chapter 66, beginning from verse 19, the Bible says, and I will set a sign among them. Who are these people? And what is a sign? Well, according to Exodus chapter 31 and verse 17, a sign symbolizes a seal or a mark. So who are these people? Having understood that the sign symbolizes the mark or the seal, and I will set a sign among them, and I will send those that escape of them to the nations, to Tarshish, to Port Alud that draw the bow, to Tubal and to Javan, to the islands afar off that have not heard my fame, neither have seen my glory, and they shall declare my glory amongst the Gentiles. Now here, first of all, in verse 19, God says, I'm going to set a mark or a seal among these people. And after I have sealed them, I'm going to send them to the nations afar off, who have not heard my fame, neither have seen my glory. And they shall declare my glory, the glory of my love, the glory of my truth, the glory of Revelation 18 and verse 1 that fills the whole earth. Now tell me, brethren, can that take place after Jesus comes or after he throws down the censer? No. So the point is, after these people escape, because that's what verse 19 says, I'm going to set a sign among them and I'm going to send those that escape. They escape something. Unto the nations, and then they will declare my glory amongst the Gentiles. Now in verse 20 the Bible says, Isaiah 66 and verse 20, and they shall bring all your brethren for an offering unto the Lord out of all nations. These escaped ones will bring all their brethren out of all nations upon horses and chariots, in litters, upon mules, upon swift beasts, to my holy mountain Jerusalem, saith the Lord. Who are these people? Pay close attention. Who are these people? As the children of Israel, the Bible says, as the children of Israel bring an offering into a clean vessel, into the house of the Lord. Since it's the children of Israel that are bringing their brethren from all nations into a clean vessel, and since all the books of the Bible meet and end in Revelation, Acts of the Apostles 5:85, who were the Israelites that were sealed in Revelation chapter 7 and verse 4? The 144,000. John says, and I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 from all the tribes of the children of Israel. Brothers and sisters, that is the 144,000. And according to volume 3, Testaments to the Church, page 266, Inspiration says, the closing work for the church is the sealing of the 144,000. These are the sealed ones of Isaiah 66 and verse 19. After God seals them, he will then send them to the nations to bring all their brethren, notice the bottom of verse 20, into a clean vessel. Don't miss that point, brethren. They bring their brethren into a clean vessel into the house of the Lord, showing that the house of the Lord must have been purified before the 144,000 go out to declare God's glory to those who have not heard it. Now, brethren, since they escaped something, let's just go back to verse 16. Let's go back to verse 16. Isaiah 66 and verse 16. Verse 16 says, for by fire, which is a symbol of God's Holy Spirit, Acts chapter 2 and verse 2, remember on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit set as tongues of fire upon the 120 disciples. For by fire and by my sword, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, Ephesians 6 and verse 17. So for by fire, the Holy Spirit, and by his sword, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, will the Lord plead with all flesh. And then it says, the slain of the Lord shall be many. Now since God is saying here, for by fire and by his sword, will the Lord plead with all flesh. Can this be taking place, brethren, at Christ's second coming? Can this happen when Christ comes in the clouds of glory? Will Christ Jesus be pleading with anybody when he comes in the clouds of glory? Certainly not. Because at that time, he would have already thrown down the censer and pronounced that mandate. Let him who is filthy, let him be filthy still. Righteous, let him be righteous still. Holy, let him be holy still. And then after that, the seven last plagues fall. So here he's saying, for by fire and by his sword will the Lord plead with all flesh. But those who do not accept the pleading during probationary time, the Bible says, the slain of the Lord shall be many. So while he's pleading with some and sealing some, he will be slaying others. My brothers and sisters, we need to understand this. Because according to verse 19, those who escape this slaying, because again, verse 16 says, the slain of the Lord shall be many. What is this slaying? What is this slaying, brethren? In volume 1, Testaments to the Church, page 190, Inspiration says, page 190, the pen of inspiration says, "Many I saw were flattering themselves that they were good Christians, who have not a single ray of light from Jesus. They know not what it means to be renewed by the grace of God. They have no living experience for themselves in the things of God. And I saw that the Lord was whetting his sword in heaven to cut them down. Oh, that every lukewarm professor could realize the clean work that God is about to make amongst his professed people." The professed people of God are the Seventh-day Adventist people, brethren. But the point is, inspiration says, "And I saw that the Lord was whetting his sword in heaven to cut them down. Oh, that every lukewarm professor could realize the clean work that God is about to make amongst his professed people." My brothers and sisters, this slaying of the Lord in Isaiah chapter 66 and verse 16 is exactly what we are reading here in volume 1, Testaments to the Church, page 190. "I saw that the Lord was whetting his sword in heaven to cut them down." So what I'm really sharing with you today, brethren, is this: that the actual cutting out of the stone from the mountain, again showing a separation, symbolizes the purification of the church, the slaying of the Lord, the slaughter of Ezekiel chapter 9, of the five men who are angels, each having slaughter weapons in their hands. After God purifies the church, after the slaughter of Ezekiel chapter 9, which according to manuscript releases, volume 1, page 260, inspiration says there, in volume 1 of the manuscript releases, page 260, inspiration says, "Study the ninth chapter of Ezekiel. These words will be literally fulfilled." Literally fulfilled. "Yet the time is passing and the people are asleep. They refuse to humble their souls and to be converted." They refuse to do that. And that's why God is going to have to purify the church, brethren. And then after he purifies the church, after the slaying of the Lord takes place, of Isaiah 66 and verse 16, then according to verse 19, God will then send those who escape, the sealed ones, he will then send those that escape to the nations afar off that have not heard God's fame, showing that when probation closes for the church, in the slaughter of Ezekiel 9, probation will still be open for the world. No wonder Peter says in 1 Peter 4:17, that the time is come when judgment must first begin in the house of God. Oh brethren, we are living in a most solemn and fearful time. The great day of God is right upon us. It hasteneth greatly. And that's why we need to strive now to be amongst the 144,000 who will actually be separated, purified. In Psalm chapter 1, and verse 5 and 6, let's just go there very quickly, brethren. In Psalm chapter 1 and verse 5 and 6, the Bible says, "Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment." And where does judgment begin? In the house of God. "Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous." Did you get the point, brethren? "Nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous." When judgment begins in the house of God, no sinners will actually stand in the congregation of the righteous, in the church. Because God will manifest that his fan is in his hand and he will thoroughly purge his floor. So going back to Daniel chapter 2, brethren, when the 144,000 symbolized by this stone, after probation is closed for the church, in the slaughter of Ezekiel chapter 9, symbolized by the cutting out, then the 144,000, according to Isaiah 66 and verse 19, they will go to the nations afar off that have not heard his fame, God's fame, and then they will bring their brethren into the purified church. Showing again that probation will first close for the church. Oh, brothers and sisters, we need to really come to Jesus with a humble and a contrite heart. And we need to be sincere with our own souls. That if we have been reading, if as we read, we see that our former opinions are in conflict with the Word of God, we have to put those opinions to the side. And we have to plant our feet upon the everlasting rock of the eternal truth. Oh, brethren, flesh and blood has not revealed this message. Flesh and blood has not revealed it. But our Father, who loves us so much. You see, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? And that's why God has seen fit, brethren, right now, to give us the truth in relation to Daniel chapter 2. For many years we have been teaching that this stone is Christ, but we've seen that is not the case, brethren. That is not the case. But rather, it is Christ reproduced through his church. Christ in you and me, the hope of glory. My beloved brethren, I trust that we will be like the Bereans. And we will fast and pray and review this study time and time again. Because no one can decide which side you're going to be on, brethren. No one can decide for you. You have to decide for yourself. And to march on, even if the multitude are against you. Love you so much. May God cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. In Jesus' precious and matchless name. Lord, your preciousness, your grace. Save us, Lord. Help us to be amongst these people, Lord. Help us to be sanctified by your truth. Your word is truth. And be of your people, Lord. Do not allow the enemy to pluck the seeds that were sown in the minds of your children's mind right now, Lord. Oh, Father, help us, Lord. Help us to have a shelter in Jesus' precious name. Amen. And amen.
Trust that your hearts have been stirred by the ever-unfolding revelations of God's prophetic word. There are also many more prophecy studies available to you. For further information, please contact us at 1-800-729-7494 or visit us on the World Wide Web at www.3angelsherald.org. Thank you.